Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's Expert Talks on Urban Air Mobility. My name is Elena Campos, and I'll be coordinating the session today. I work in the marketing team here at Hinkle Aviation Space and Rail, and I'm excited to be hosting this session today. I'm pleased to introduce today's speakers, Kai Plötner from Bauhaus Luftfahrt, Stefan Bauer from Roland Berger, and Rory O'Kane from Hinkle. Before I hand over to Rory, I have a few housekeeping items to cover about this presentation and the GoToWebinar platform at all. First, today's webinar recording will be available on demand after the live session, and it's accessible through the same registration page you used. Please make sure you use Google Chrome for this. Next, we'd love to hear from you during today's presentation. If you have a question for our speakers, please feel free to send it through the chat box on the GoToWebinar panel. We'll be answering questions at the end of the session. Feel free to use the function raise your hand if you need any additional support. If we don't get to your question today, we will be sure to follow up afterwards. And last, we'd like to encourage you to let us know how you like today's session by filling out the survey at the end. This will help us for future expert talks. So, without any further comments, I'd like to kick things off by welcoming Rory O'Kane, Head Global Strategy, Aviation Space and Rail. Rory, over to you.
Thank you, Elena, and thank you everyone for joining us this morning, this afternoon, for this expert talk on an exciting new market segment within our aerospace aviation industry, urban air mobility, which I'm sure everyone has heard an awful lot about. And so, you know, I'm really happy today to be joined by two experts in the area, Kai Plötner from Bauhaus Luftfahrt and Stefan Bauer from Roland Berger. So Kai, maybe you want to give a quick introduction to yourself and what Bauhaus Luftfahrt do?
For sure. Thank you so much. I also welcome you from Munich. Good afternoon. So my name is Kai Plötner. I'm head of economics and transportation team at Bauhaus Luftfahrt. So I have an experience of roughly 15 years of aviation research and long-term aviation research. I'm at Bauhaus Luftfahrt for more than 10 years, and we are looking at UAM more than 4 years on a research perspective. From a background, I'm an aeronautical engineer, and also holding a PhD from the Technical University of Munich. So what Bauhaus is about, so we are a long-term aviation think tank, which was founded by the industry. So for example, like Airbus, MTU Aero Engines, Lippe Aerospace, and also IABG together with the German government or the Bavarian government. And our job is to anticipate the future development of aviation. So we're looking at technologies which might come into the next 20 or 30 years, and also we are trying to anticipate how aviation might look like in the next 20 or 30 years. And urban air mobility is one of our hot topics, I can admit.
Excellent. Thank you, Kai. And then Stefan Bauer is a principal of aerospace and defense at Roland Berger. You're a management consultant with a strong expertise in the aerospace and defense sector, and have recently published a number of excellent research reports on urban air mobility. Stefan, if you want to give a little introduction to yourself, and I know then you're going to give us a short presentation on some of the future market dynamics of this exciting new segment.
Thanks a lot for this. So basically, my name is Stefan Bauer. Now, 10 years with Roland Berger, also studied aerospace engineering before with a focus on flight control systems. So I already looked into the topic of drone and autonomous flight during my studies. And now at Roland Berger, I'm focusing on the aerospace and defense segment, and also since about 4 years, in particular on urban air mobility. And we at Roland Berger also look at the topic of urban air mobility from three different perspectives. So first of all, being active in different verticals like automotive, transportation, aerospace, we have quite a good view of the whole 360 degree mobility ecosystem, and also know, for example, how to connect first and last mile with the urban air mobility flight. Then, as already mentioned, have done some thought leadership in urban air mobility during the last couple of years, given studies, given webinars, and also during the last 1 to 2 years, also major projects that we have conducted within the field of urban air mobility. And third, based on our studies, based on our projects and also webinars, we've up to now built up quite a strong network within the urban air mobility ecosystem, which also allows us in order to develop this content. And I'm now very happy to also discuss this very nice and emerging industry with you.
Excellent. And thank you, Stefan. We'll roll into a short presentation from yourself to really give us the overarching market dynamics and introduce the topic for those that may be not as familiar with it before we then roll into the panel discussion. So thank you for that.
You're welcome. So basically what we see is that urban air mobility is driven by five major topics. First of all, we see heavy congestion in urban areas, which decrease the job productivity by up to 10%. Second, we also see that in 2050, around 67% of the global world's population will reside in this kind of urban areas. We also see that the airspace over these larger urban areas is still quite empty. But on the other side, we also have heavy population growth, which outpaces up to threefold the capacity growth of public transportation networks. In addition, now with COVID-19, we also have a new global disease, which also triggers social distancing. And all of these five topics together push urban air mobility, and this kind of urban air mobility adds a new mobility dimension and also complements the existing transportation systems that we have now. We at Roland Berger see three major use cases within urban air mobility for passenger transport. It's on the one side, city taxi. These are quite short on-demand flights between any available landing station within a city, similar to what you have currently already with helicopter services, for example, in Sao Paulo. Second, we see airport shuttles, which are scheduled flights on defined routes between a city center or multiple points within a city center and the airport. And third, we see intercity transport, meaning building up a regional network of about 50 to 250 kilometers with this kind of urban air mobility vehicles. By the year 2050, based on our market models, we estimate to have 160,000 drones flying in the skies. And these drones make up a market of over 90 billion euro. This market, based on our view, will then more or less be equally split between airport shuttle and intercity transport, which will make up around 90% of the market. And city taxi will only be a smaller portion, also based on the shorter distances and typically also lower amount of passengers for these kind of vehicles and use case. One interesting fact that we see today is that we have a lot of different concepts, and we see that a lot of companies being active in the field of urban air mobility today are starting from a technical concept, developing the best technical concept, but not think about the use case in the first glance. However, we think that it should be the other way around, meaning first, as a company, you need to think about what will be the most promising use case for you. Is it city taxi? Is it airport shuttle or intercity transport? And based on this one, then define the best possible technical concept from your end. You have on the one side, highly distributed propulsion concepts or quadrocopters, similar to what we see at EHang or Volocopter. These kind of vehicles are best suited for city taxi and airport shuttle transport because they're quite efficient for vertical takeoff and landing, but not so efficient for longer distances. On the other end, you have fixed wing concepts, which are very good for intercity transport, but are not so efficient for vertical takeoff and landing. What we also see is that during the last 2 to 3 years, we've seen quite a lot of partnerships and a whole ecosystem emerge. We have on the one side traditional automotive companies, be it Hyundai, be it Daimler, or Toyota, that are investing into this kind of urban air mobility companies, like for example Toyota and Joby, Daimler and Volocopter, more as financial investors, or also companies like Hyundai, which are building up really their own urban air mobility divisions. On the other side, we have also startups like EHang and Lilium, which are financed by tech companies, also by venture capital funds, or the traditional aerospace and defense companies like Airbus and Boeing, partnering also with these kind of startups or with the automotive companies. But in addition, we also see traditional mobility and logistics providers, like for example Deutsche Bahn Schenker, investing into companies like Square Airports or Volocopter in order to support also the buildup of this whole ecosystem. Going forward, we see four major building blocks that need to be kept in mind and need to be developed by companies in order to be successful in urban air mobility. It's first of all, you need to define a commercial feasibility of your product, meaning what kind of use cases do you want to serve? Are you doing it alone or via partnerships? And also, what is your business concept? How do you go to the market? Second major pillar is social feasibility, and also in particular the public acceptance, meaning people need to be willing to fly with your vehicles, but they also need to be willing to have this kind of vertiports next to your house or also vehicles flying over them. Third topic is technical feasibility, meaning on the one side, how can you achieve the certification for your vehicles, but also how do your vehicles connect and interrelate with the available infrastructure and the interaction with public transport. And finally, you need to have the industrial feasibility, meaning you need to have a sustainable business model, but also your technology of the vehicle, also the integration into the infrastructure and the existing public transportation network needs to be scalable in order to have really a reliable business case. This would be everything from our side. So thanks a lot and looking forward to the discussion with you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Stefan. That was a really good introduction to the overall segment and you know, introducing some of the challenges that we'll discuss now through the panel discussion. So if you're ready, I've got a few questions just to address some of the topics that we've discussed. So on the market outlook and dynamics, do you think expect to see a change post-COVID, either more rapid implementation or timelines being pushed to the right? Maybe Stefan, just first for yourself.
Thanks a lot. So very good question about the whole COVID topic. We also made up our mind quite a lot about this one. And basically, we don't see a major roadblock from COVID-19 on urban air mobility. Of course, it might be shifted a little bit on the timeline, maybe half a year, but looking at the overall quite, let's say, long implementation period, thinking about 2025 for first commercial operation, speaking about 2030 when we see really the scale up of the market, half a year to 1 year is not that big issue or difference. And also when looking more into the details, we see the technology and certification are still driven forward, maybe a little bit with less progress on some of the startups, while other startups are pushing more. And also some of the aerospace companies might have issues for financing it. But on the other side, we as Roland Berger see also quite a lot of automotive companies now speeding up the transformation towards a whole mobility provider and increasing even their investment into urban air mobility.
Okay, yeah, really interesting. On the whole topic of sustainability, obviously it's a major discussion point and not just for commercial aerospace, but for all aspects of mobility related to urbanization and travel. And do you think that the increased focus with commercial aerospace through companies like Airbus and some of the engine manufacturers announcing future plans for alternative propulsion technologies, whether it be synthetic aviation fuels, hybrids, hydrogen, electric type propulsion, and do you think that will accelerate or not the development of UAM vehicles and the kind of propulsion technology that's there? Kai, maybe to yourself.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I have to say it depends on. So the question is, first of all, do you see any spin-off or any synergy effects you have of, for example, a hydrogen fuel cell battery system if you apply that to a UAM application? Do you see any, let's say, benefits if you apply that to a regional aircraft or let's say also A320 type aircraft or even bigger? So the answer is, if we're looking at fuel cell systems or at the fuel cells itself, yes, there are spin-offs. So it's just a question about you have to organize your stacks. But if you're talking about thermal management, then it's completely different story. So there are differences in there. And also what both, or let's say what all questions, or let's say aspects have to be answered is, I mean, where does the hydrogen comes from? This is independent of we're talking about a UAM or in a large passenger aircraft. And also what I have to say is, I mean, the fuel cell or hydrogen, I mean, we're talking here all the time just about electric vehicles. So if we are not talking about here that we are taking a combustion engine and fueling it with synthetic aviation fuels or even hydrogen. So we're just talking about batteries, maybe with fuel cell in combination.
Sure. Stefan, do you have any additional to add on the sustainability topic? A big discussion right now as well is on the source. You talk about the source of hydrogen, Kai, but also the source of lithium for a lot of the battery systems. And do we see that having an impact on the development of batteries and electric propulsion?
So basically, completely agree to everything what Kai just said, but maybe adding one point, what we see currently, what is important when looking at sustainability is not only to look at, let's say, this propulsion system and the energy, but also as a third pillar to also take into account the production of the drones and the supply chain, meaning also beside battery, what kind of other materials to use for the production of the drones, but also how is the supply chain built up? Meaning to have a supply chain like nowadays in large commercial aviation industry, where parts are transported twice, three times over the globe until you have the final assembly of the aircraft, or do you possibly have in future somehow local supply chains around the OEM, around those kind of urban air mobility manufacturers, where let's say all the tier one, tier two, tier three suppliers are located in order to also have, let's say, more sustainable supply chains, more sustainable eVTOL vehicles, even from the production perspective.
Yeah, definitely interesting. Next question, maybe just from overall approach, and you touched upon a little bit, Stefan, on the perception and the social aspect, but what do you think might be the biggest challenge for growth? Will it be the vehicle design certification? Will it be the development of the infrastructure? Or could it be more on that public perception piece?
Very interesting question. So basically, when we did our first study about 2 years ago, it was actually all what you just mentioned. Now, 2 years later, we have seen that, let's say, technology has moved quite nicely forward. There are some roadblocks, but by looking to the future, you also see that those kind of issues might be solved. By looking at certification, we see that both FAA and EASA are working quite nicely together with the companies being active in the field of urban air mobility in order to jointly develop the respective regulations, the requirements for certification. However, what we currently see when talking to people within the field of urban air mobility is the whole aspect about public acceptance, meaning how can you convince people to fly with this kind of vehicles? How can you convince people to be happy or to be okay with vertiports next to their homes and also to be okay with vehicles flying over them? And what we see as one important point going forward is that you somehow convince the people by starting first with cargo use cases, showing them that those kind of operations of drones are safe, also that the noise level, the visual pollution is not too dramatic, and then basically based on this, going also into passenger use cases and then scaling it up.
Interesting. Kai, anything to add to that?
No, I'm also fully with Stefan. I think also the public perception, it depends on, let's say, which kind of application you have. I mean, Stefan already mentioned the freight, or also the passenger, but there is also lots of efficiency gains we can see on the service side. I give you just only one example from the Deutsche Bahn. They have now a project starting observing the train tracks in Germany and trying to identify where are, let's say, trees and plants which can, let's say, limit your operation maybe after storms and so on. And this has a huge productivity increase. And there also maybe the passengers or the publication, the public can see that aerial solutions will give a positive benefit to the society. And maybe this is an entry point where drones are, let's say, better perceived rather than just a gimmick, for example, of camera systems right now.
Okay, yeah, very interesting. One question that is more very recent and maybe get both of your opinions on how it might affect the overall development of the market and the OEMs is the recent Joby Uber announcement. So obviously Uber Elevate was kind of an umbrella with Hyundai, Bell, Wisk, Joby, all part of that kind of consortium development. Do you think this is what we should expect to see within this space, a lot of movement and merger acquisition type activity? And do you think it might result in, you know, less players in the market overall? Stefan, maybe do you want to comment and then Kai?
Yes, happy to comment first. So basically, yes, we expect consolidation within the market in the next years. It would be like in every market, every industry that you have seen. We think that urban air mobility will develop similar to what we have seen in the automotive industry in the last 100, 120 years, but maybe, let's say, in a time frame of only 20 years. And we will have a lot of companies now building, developing those kind of vehicles, but then sooner, around 2025, 2030, we think that a dominant design will emerge for each of the use cases or even across different use cases. And based on this, you will also have then a dropout of companies, but also consolidation of companies. Going back to the case that you mentioned with Joby and Uber, it's quite interesting because we have in the past perceived Uber as a company with the target in order to be agnostic, meaning being really able to, let's have different companies that can go into their ecosystem. And we are now, let's say, questioning ourselves how Joby wants to, let's say, drive this further. This is the interesting topic and this is the interesting question, I think, going forward.
Yep. Okay. Any additional comment before we move on?
Yeah, I mean, say for Uber or let's say for most of the companies right now, I mean, it's very difficult to keep your cash, and also, I mean, for Uber or Uber Elevate, I mean, it's one of the moonshot programs they have, and I think it's a management decision to say, look, we have to prioritize our businesses, and they are now focusing, let's say, on the core business, and this is what we see. Also in, for other companies that nowadays they are focusing more on the core business.
Yep. Okay, excellent. Shifting gears a little bit from maybe more the market, and you had a nice graphic, Stefan, on the different form factors or use cases, but on some of the design challenges, you know, what do you think are some of the key challenges for the OEMs, whether to go with a fixed wing rotorcraft and you kind of highlighted a little bit of how this could be impacted by use case.
So what we think OEMs should do, or companies that would like to go into the field of urban air mobility should do, is also what we're currently discussing and doing in projects with clients from us. It's really the typical question, how does the whole value chain look like and where are the major buckets along the value chain? And one of the questions when thinking about the major buckets along the value chain, meaning revenue-wise, but also profit-wise, is really which kind of use cases do you want to serve in the future? And then as a next question, how can you best possibly serve these kind of use cases? And based on this, think about, is it more a quadrocopter, highly distributed propulsion concept, or would it be more, let's say, a fixed wing concept? I think this is the major thing that you need to take into account, technically speaking. What is interesting to see is that most of the solutions that we see currently are, let's say, really electrical propulsion focused. We only see 1% or one or two solutions currently of all projects on the market, which are hydrogen based or based on traditional combustion engines. So this is an interesting factor to see. And when going forward regarding technological challenges, I think it's on the one side, of course, the battery concept, but I also had an interesting discussion with our automotive experts in yesterday, and they said when looking at the different car manufacturers, it's not only the battery which makes up a good e-mobility car, it's really the whole propulsion system and also how the different components work together. And I think this is also important for air mobility to take into account, that it's not only the battery or the motor, but it's also the propulsion system which you select in order to really, let's say, fulfill then your final requirements regarding distance, regarding speed, regarding also, let's say, charging time and so on.
Yeah, excellent, Jan. That definitely leads me into the next question that I'll direct to you, Kai, on the how the value chain will develop. So if we look at, as Stefan pointed out, on the automotive value chain and the supply chain is pretty mature, likewise it is for traditional aerospace, but with the eVTOL urban air mobility space, there's been a lot of the OEMs have been very vertically integrated, very secretive, confidentiality around their designs, both from a battery, powertrain, and vehicle, overall vehicle design. How do you think you might see that develop as the industry matures?
Mm-hmm. I would like to let's say, impose another question, or just answering it another way around. I mean, first of all, we have nowadays helicopter OEMs like Airbus, Sikorsky, Boeing. And I mean, they have to improve their product portfolio. So they have to look at how can we make our product more efficient? How can we make it, let's say, zero emission? So there should be some more activities regarding that, and also that they're tapping into the areas of UAM. But the fundamental question is, what is the core competency right over there? And we see that in that respect, autonomy and also the powertrain or battery system, these are, let's say, the critical aspects we see. And also this heavily drives how it will be integrated and also how the segment will mature.
Okay, yeah, great, thank you. Then kind of leading from that, and what is of specific interest to Henkel and a lot of our customers is really around then moving from that design and supply chain aspects then into, you know, the material selection for those designs. So, you know, if we were to think about material selection and the certification topic as well, as it ties in with airworthiness and aspects of that. So how does it think the certification will influence the material selection, you know, with currently going with aerospace qualified materials, maybe over other materials that could be incorporated from other industries, composite industries, wind, marine, and maybe from automotive as well. Kai, any comments to that or any input?
If I may, let's say, ask more, this is Stefan, because honestly, materials is not my specific...
Okay, sorry.
No worries.
Stefan, to yourself, the automotive, thank you.
No, happy to answer it and also give my view on this topic. So basically, what we currently see is that in order to have these kind of vehicles flying, you need two major kind of certification. First one is you need to have, let's say, the certification for the vehicle itself. But in aerospace, you also need to have the certification as a company, like design organization approval, production organization approval, and so on. And basically, for both of these kind of organization certifications, we see that FAA and EASA are currently, let's say, adopting existing regulations, in particular FAA, by taking general aviation regulation and adapting it to air mobility. EASA is building up their own ones, but also, let's say, not too far away from the FAA ones. And what I expect is that in order to have these kind of vehicles flying, you also might need to have this kind of, let's say, aviation grade, aviation certified materials, at least in the beginning. And then I think at some point of time, you might have the business case in order to think about how many drones do you produce per year? Also, what is the material that you need? And then to think about, do you still go to the, let's say, existing aviation certified materials, or do you also have a business case taking into account automotive materials, taking into account wind turbine materials, but also do this kind of certification for this kind of materials? So this would be my view on the topic.
Okay, thank you. And maybe as a follow on to that, you know, obviously with, if you take commercial, maybe aerospace versus UAM, there's definitely a shift in kind of agility and maybe speed to market. And do you think, not that there would ever be any aspect of not looking into obviously the safety aspects of it, but maybe there's much more of a first to market approach with the UAM versus a commercial. And do you think that the decisions, material decisions, will be based more on performance and requirements, or that need to qualify and certify first to be that really first to market with a commercial solution?
Based on my view, it would be, let's say, really performance, because in the end, of course, you have now prototypes with demonstrators, but at the moment it's, let's say, really on a low scale. And you have now still 5 to 6 years to go until the market really picks up, until you have the scale up of the market. And I think until this, you also have time to certify your material. So for me, it comes down to, let's say, either resistance, it comes down to weight, it comes down to other performance criteria, but it would be rather from the performance angle, not so much from the certification angle, okay. But also, of course, cost to some extent.
Sure. And do you think then that from that certification first and performance, and you kind of alluded to a little bit that maybe as the industry and the knowledge matures within what those use cases are, that there might then be more adoption of materials that were more traditional to, say, automotive or some of the other industrial industries, particularly on, say, adhesives and composite materials?
I think so, because let's say aviation grade or current aviation materials are typically not that cheap, they are expensive. others from other industries are because they have much higher volumes, let's say much cheaper, much more cost efficient. And therefore, I think that at some point in time, you will go also to these. But it depends really, let's say, if this kind of time or point in time will be already in 5 years from now on, or if it would be rather in 10 years from now on. I think this is the interesting question.
And do you think then will the manufacturing processes then, it'll need to be more in line with very automated production lines from the automotive industry versus sometimes a much more labor intensive production processes from aerospace?
Also very interesting point, because we also had in the beginning when we started actually the mindset and the thought that it needs to be automated, it needs to be automotive like. But then looking really at the number of drones that you will need, you see that it's about a factor of 10 compared to what you currently produce in aerospace. So it's not that much different. And other topic, by looking at, let's say, the cost base, you see that, let's say, the initial cost of the vehicle are not the major issue. For example, if you think about $800,000 for a vehicle, but if you think you need to pilot it, you have another 300,000, let's say, costs per year for the pilots, at least taking two or three pilots into account. So meaning even if you save 20% of manufacturing costs by automation, you only have the break even after 1 year compared to, let's say, going autonomous. So what we think currently that of course you need to take into account that the manufacturing costs are not too high, but really manufacturing costs are not the major issue in our point of view. The scale up of the market will really come when you go into autonomy, because then you won't have pilots and then you will have, let's say, a huge step change in the operational cost of the vehicles.
Excellent. And I'm glad you brought up the point of piloted versus autonomous, because it leads me then into the next discussion topic around the ability of air taxis to fly autonomously. And to yourself, Guy, you know, what do you think are the challenges and timelines or the implications for implementation of an autonomous flying vehicle?
All right. Yeah. I mean, what we already saw is that we had autonomous flights, for example, by EHang, also Volocopter, but these were done under very favorable environmental conditions. And also what we see is that autonomous flying vehicles are also known for decades if we are talking about military applications. So from the technology point of view, it's not that, let's say, demanding or let's say immature. But the problem is more, or the devil is in the details. So what are the critical aspects? So what still is unsolved so far is everything regarding how you're organizing or you're controlling the air traffic in that respect. So everything regarding air traffic management, or we call it UTM. So they are large of processes and decisions are not made yet. It's also the question about sense and avoid. So we have different participants, starting from large aircraft going to general aviation. We have small drones. You have to ensure that they know each other or they detect each other. This is also what have to be, clarified. And last but not least, I mean, also Stefan already indicated that. I mean, for example, the EASA is doing a great step into that we are having a drone regulation starting of next year, at least that first steps of flying in 150 meter height next year under the same rules within Europe. So this is a great step, but going, let's say, for large air taxis with 2, 3, 4 passengers, it will take a longer time. Also the type certification of the vehicles. So maybe we can see in the next 2 or 3 years, test and demonstrator flights, maybe also with some passengers. Regarding commercial flights, maybe a little bit longer.
Bit longer before there's even the public acceptance of getting into a vehicle that is autonomous, maybe to fly around.
I mean, first of all, I mean, as Stefan indicated, you need the autonomy to bring the operating cost down. But when you're starting the operation, I mean, you're not starting. I mean, you're starting the operation as we have it today. I mean, it's helicopter services, and you're targeting, let's say, the high income people, just a small proportion of the population, and this is your starting point. And if you're starting with these ones, I mean, you do not have to fly autonomously, but you have to prepare your architecture, your technologies, so from the scratch on, so you can switch from piloted to autonomous. But you do not need that from the beginning on.
And so taking and looking at that business model and the viability of it being like proliferating across and being much more common than just, as you say, Kai, kind of the helicopter services, obviously the cost per flight is going to be more significant if you've got a piloted vehicle. And I've seen that Lufthansa and Lilium are now in a partnership to train pilots. But, you know, how do you think that will change in relation to, you know, a UAM pilot versus obviously a commercial pilot versus then an autonomous? Like, how long do you think it might take to see that transition to more autonomous? And as you say, will it be the intercity use case will be more piloted, and then the air taxi needs to be much more autonomous?
That's a very good question. Maybe also Stefan can help me with that respect. I mean, there are different, let's say, different steps. So first of all, if we think about, okay, UAM will be a pilot niche application, and still we are talking here about a market size which is 2, 3, 6 times bigger than the helicopter market today. So even under these conditions, there's a huge market potential. If we are going into autonomy, I mean, then we are talking about market shares which are, let's say, right, much higher than we know in aviation, but also then. I mean, we are speaking here about autonomy again, and also high load factors. And I just want to give you one number when we're talking about acceptability. 30 to 40% of all the passengers experience fear of flying to a certain level. And this is also what you have to take into account when you want to introduce autonomy to this new mode of transport. And also I want to give you an example about the past. So when lift or elevators were introduced, there was a so-called lift boy, because the people were afraid to step into an elevator. So this is also what we have to think about. How can we enter or bring this new technology to the public, to the population, that they're accepting it, and also that we are doing the right steps to start from today's a very small niche and enable a certain market uptake.
Very interesting history on the elevator introduction. I didn't know, but it's a good analogy. Stefan, anything to add before we close this section of the discussion?
No, I think it was already quite complete, because I think it perfectly adds to what I said before and fully agree with what Kai said. So perfect ending.
Okay, excellent. Look, thank you both. I think that was a really good discussion. And now, Elena, do we want to take a few questions that have come in from the audience?
Sure, we actually have some here. The first one goes to Kai. Kai, you said companies are focusing on their core. Would this mean that Boeing and Airbus will not be a big player in the UAM market? Are they waiting for a startup being successful and then acquire it?
No, I mean, helicopters is one of the core businesses at Airbus, for example. So they will continue with looking at how to improve their product portfolio. But also what they are looking at is, I mean, the core business, for example, at Airbus, is to develop the vehicle. It's not their core business to look at maybe building up vertiports and operating vertiports. So this is something, let's say, where we believe this will be done under partnership agreements, under so-called UAM ecosystem, where Airbus, for example, or an aircraft manufacturer will focus on the vehicle design.
Right, thank you. We have another one to both of you, actually, Stefan and Kai. What is the impact of Israeli companies on the aerospace industry now and in the future? Is there any specific company in particular?
Very good question. So what I would start with is that you have, let's say, when looking at drones, you have currently already in the US and also in Israel, let's say quite a good heritage also coming from the military field, meaning about how to design drones, also about how to make those kind of flight controllers. And I think that this kind of knowledge could also be used for the civil world. If it is, let's say, now specific to Israel, I don't know. I think it's rather specific what you often have in aerospace, that you have ecosystems, meaning a few companies, maybe also partnering up with research institutes, with universities that are in a specific country, are in a specific location, which drives these kind of topics. And here I see the, let's say, more military clusters in the US and Israel. I see now within urban air mobility in the civil sectors, these kind of clusters coming up in Europe, for example, around Munich, also in the US. And as you said, there could be also some kind of, let's say, leverage and also benefits from each other. How do you see it, Kai?
Nothing to add. No, I see it. Okay. I see it. Very, very similar, yeah.
Okay.
Good. Thank you, Elena. Any more before we move into the introduction to some of the Henkel?
Yes, so we still have three more,
sure.
So maybe
excellent.
We can cover them briefly. So the first one is, what are the main hurdles slowing down implementation, this into reality, governmental framework approvals or public acceptance?
Maybe they belongs to each other. I mean, if we're talking about Western democratic democracies, I mean, then public perception and governmental support are linked to each other. So this is also the reason why we have to show, let's say for Western countries, a public benefit.
Good. Thank you. Okay, next one. What are the expectations about the supply chain of hydrogen, local production at major hubs?
I think that the whole topic of hydrogen for urban air mobility is very much dependent on the introduction of hydrogen for automotive and for the general, or let's say, aviation industry in general, let's call it like this, because you really need to have, let's say, whole supply, whole infrastructure network for hydrogen. And as soon as this is available from the automotive field, also from the aviation field in general, I think it also could become relevant for urban air mobility, looking then to the details or the technical details. But I think urban air mobility will not be the industry that pushes the build-up of hydrogen industry or hydrogen infrastructure.
Thank you. And last one, are there limiting factors in urban areas ensuring power supply for you? For a UAM?
Yeah, it is. I mean, if we're talking about existing buildings with existing power supply and power grids, and you want to operate a new vertiport on top of the roof with certain movements, I mean, we are talking about a megawatt of energy supply, and normally the buildings are not made for that. So this is an issue, and the second one is depending on, let's say, how large your electric vehicle UAN network and the cities are looking like. This is also an impact on the energy network in cities. But let's say from my or our perspective, I mean, the market shares are much lower compared to electric mobility on the ground. So I see from the grid perspective, I do not see so much issues.
Perfect, thank you. So then now, Rory, over to you.
Thank you. So thank you. So thank you, Kai. Thank you, Stefan, for that really good discussion on the overall market and some of the challenges facing some of the design criteria. So I want to just introduce some of what, you know, we believe, Henkel, we can help to support this growing segment. And one of the questions might be, well, why Henkel? But so from our point of view, you know, Henkel do have a strong expertise in the aerospace and defense sector. We are a market leader in adhesive sealants and functional coatings. One of the things that we do and here at Henkel and have a very strong global footprint. So, you know, we believe from the point of view you look at what Kai and Stefan just discussed in relation to the the market dynamics and the different participants. And Henkel are well positioned to supply and support materials both from an OEM perspective and from an MRO, which we didn't really touch upon, but ultimately there will need to be an MRO infrastructure, and our global footprint, I think, really puts us in an excellent position. We talked a little bit about, you know, the types of technologies and the material selection, you know, from traditional aerospace materials to other industries. And I think, you know, here at Henkel, we definitely have a strong portfolio of materials supporting automotive and specifically on the e-mobility space that we think are very well positioned to leverage within this new space of urban air mobility. So some of the challenges that were discussed in relation to the vehicle design and the vehicle materials. So everything related to electric propulsion and the simplicity of the powertrains, trying to achieve lower maintenance costs and really increasing battery capacity and lower the battery costs and some of the challenges with increasing battery capacity and power density. Obviously, we just towards the end, Kai had a really nice introduction to piloted versus autonomous. And obviously autonomous flight is really where a lot of the industry needs to get to be much more commercially viable from the point of view of a business model. And we've seen with the implementation of ADAS, so autonomous driving and safety within e-mobility, a lot of technology around cameras, LiDAR technology, and high-speed communication. Obviously for the tracking of these the vehicles, and then onto the overall structural aspect on lightweighting, obviously the materials and bonding technologies to minimize weight, which feeds into a lot of, you know, where Henkel's expertise and our portfolio of materials lie. Some of the solutions that we believe are going to be necessary and for, you know, really competent design and manufacture of these vehicles from a device assembly or vehicle assembly from, you know, our portfolio of filament paste adhesives, both aerospace grade materials as well as materials that are certified and fully in use in other industries, including automotive. Composite solutions, obviously, again, from a bonding technology and preparation. And something we didn't touch so much upon is the noise, vibration, and harshness. So, you know, both internally in the vehicle itself. If you've been in a helicopter before, they are quite noisy in that, and we will all be sitting in headsets trying to speak to each other. So being able to maintain the noise within the vehicle itself, as well as then obviously around the urban areas in which these ports will be or where these flight routes will be. From an elastomeric bonding, and my light has just gone out. If you can still see me, so again, elastomeric bonding, instant bonding technologies. From a component assembly, really looking at some of the electronic components. So from assembly filaments and electric conductive, thermally conductive and insulating materials to non-conductive and opto and photonic materials. Thermal management will certainly be a big topic, particularly as you've got a lot of electrical componentry, as well as increasing battery power densities and battery technology, the ability to ensure reliability in these electric components through good thermal management from gap fillers, gap pads, to phase change materials, and then future in conductive inks and dielectric inks and really looking at advanced electronic componentry to reduce weight, but to ensure reliability in function. One material I would like to introduce from the Henkel portfolio is new resin technology. So the resin fusion materials. So these are epoxy-based resin infusion matrix for composite structures. These are rapid cure materials. So between 15 and 20 minutes on tool cure time. So moving away from traditional prepreg technology, here you have the ability to produce complex parts using either Vartum or traditional resin transfer molding to produce, as I say, complex parts with great structural integrity. They reduce the prep and cleanup time. These are low viscosity materials, so you get excellent impregnation over large or over small complex designs. And from a performance perspective, They have high impact chemical resistance and excellent elevated temperature performance, as well as long-term stability. So everything you need really in an aerospace-grade composite material. Talked a little bit about some of the aspects of the ADAS. So the from an e-mobility, so autonomous driving and safety. So all the different componentry within that. We have materials for camera bonding, the lens to barrel, the camera module housing, looking at the barrel housing to the PCB boards, as well as even bonding within the lens itself. So a number of high quality and reliable solutions for these types of systems. And then again, taking the powertrain technology, looking at e-mobility and the battery powertrain, electrical powertrain. So we look at battery systems, the battery cell, the module, potential for the battery pack and for the control module. Again, materials like thermal interface materials, impregnation materials, gasketing, as well as structural adhesives. And then moving into more the inverter, the onboard, the DC-DC converters. Again, a lot of our thermal interface material solutions for potting, gap pads and gap fillers. And then on the actual electric motor itself, again, a lot of thermal potting, magnet bonding, as well as gasketing and impregnations. Taking a closer look at some of the battery systems, and you look at the assembly adhesives that really build up those cell-to-cell pouches, again, as well, sealing within the battery itself to protect and to maintain the reliability of the system. You have gap fillers, you have battery assembly adhesives, and again, thermal materials. The thermal topic comes up a lot, and I'll touch a little bit in the subsequent slides on what that means and what are the aspects of that thermal interface management. But yeah, there is a comprehensive portfolio at Henkel to supply materials for large-scale battery production. So thermal interface materials, for those unfamiliar, maybe describe, you know, what is a thermal interface material? So in effect, it's some type of added adhesive layer or bonding layer between components that really allow for a much more efficient heat transfer from a circuit board or from some other type of electronic components. Obviously, as miniaturization across various different industries, from power and industrial automation, datacom, telecom, obviously into the e-mobility for automotive, and now as we look to this urban air mobility and the design of vehicles and the electronic component infrastructure, there's a lot of different components and a lot of active materials trying to get into small space. And so the ability to transfer heat away from those circuit boards to maintain that reliability and ultimately then safety, and you know, as it feeds into public perception for these, is really important. And so if we look at some of Henkel's portfolio of thermal interface materials, we have gap pads and thin films that can be applied very automatically with the pick and place systems. These can be silicone or silicone free at various thicknesses with thermal conductivity, everything from 1 to 10 watt per meter Kelvin, and can be electrically conducting or electrically insulating, depend on the application. Then moving into the liquid gap fillers, these fill a similar role and application to the gap pads, but just depending on the design of the component. Again, these are silicone or silicone free, depending on the application. Are two component systems, so in your minds of like a traditional two component adhesive, but they can go to different thicknesses depending on filling out that gap that's required, and have a conductivity typically in the range of 1 to 7 watts per meter K, and can be limited with electrical isolation. We then other products within thermal gels, again, depending on the thermal conductivity requirements and whether it needs to be electrically conductive or electrically isolating, through to adhesives, films and pastes, and other insulating materials that are really designed for, you know, different applications and different levels of electronic componentry to really support the transfer of heat away from those systems. And for us, if you have any further questions on any of the portfolio from the electronic materials through the structural materials, please reach out to your local technical customer service representative. Or in the case of those with an expertise in this area, is David Zhao, whose email is here, or Anke Schutt, again, the email available here. And thank you very much. If there are any questions, I don't know if there's any questions, further questions coming through from the audience. Elena?
Nothing so far, nothing. Let's just wait maybe 1 minute, sure, and see if there's something coming up.
And maybe as we wait, in any questions, any last comments from Kai yourself?
Or at least, let's say, have a very safe and sound pre-Christmas time. Stay healthy. And I really enjoyed the talk here.
Yeah, thank you. I have to, Stefan, to yourself, before I say my last words, any additional comments from you? I think you're on mute, Stefan.
Thanks. So also, thanks a lot for my time. Thanks a lot also from my side. Also have a safe and nice Christmas. And also, what I really find interesting is to be now part of this kind of emerging new industry, some kind of new milestone in aviation. And also, I think it's great to be here to have the discussions with you, and also looking forward to what happens in this industry in the future.
Yeah. And I would say, as you know, unless there's any questions coming through, thank you very much to the both of you for agreeing to participate and to give, you know, your expertise in this really exciting area. I know there's a lot going on out there, and it's really nice to know that, you know, we can really track it, and some of the input and contributions from yourself have been really good. Anything there, Elena, unless there's no
further question? Yes, we just got one, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. So does UAV materials need airworthiness approval? Here, Judy, anyone that
do
can
the materials comment. Or the vehicles? So do the materials need an airworthiness?
Materials for UA vehicles need airworthiness approval.
From my perspective, the materials themselves will not need the approval. They will be designed similar to commercial aerospace or to meet a component specification. That may be different from an interior materials, where there's different levels of overarching FAA requirements in relation to flame, smoke, and tox. But really, it will be on the components and the certification requirements that FAA or EASA put on a specific component. I don't know, Kai or Stefan, if you have anything to add to that.
I would say that from the certification point of view, I mean, EASA is now setting up the certification rules in terms of the entire vehicle and also the performance of the vehicle. And now they're also setting up the means of compliance, how the industry can show that. And I think under these rules, I mean, the means of compliance, you also have to show that your materials, or let's say your materials have to perform. And it might be different, as we already mentioned, that there are aspects, for example, like toxicity or so, will be different for UAM applications.
Yeah.
Correct. Thank you. That's all.
Okay. Again, thank you everyone for attending that joined today. Thank you again to Kai and Stefan. Thank you very much to Elena for coordinating and organizing everything that was going on and keeping that all together. I wish everyone, it's still a week to go, but I wish everyone a very happy and safe holiday period wherever you are, and hope that in 2021 brings some slightly more improved outlook for everyone in relation to what we saw from 2020. So again, thank you very much for joining, and hope to see you again at another Henkel Expert Talk.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.